हाय फ्रेंड्स, होप यू आर डूइंग वेल। मैं सिबसंकर महाराणा आज आपके लिए लेके आया हूँ एक और वीडियो, मेरे इंडियन पॉलिटी लेक्चर का पहला वीडियो। आप अगर अभी तक मेरे चैनल को लाइक या सब्सक्राइब नहीं किए हो तो तुरंत लाइक, शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब कीजिए ताकि आपका लेक्चर मिस ना हो। आज हम इस लेक्चर के जरिए देखेंगे कि कैसे हमारा कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बना था। दोस्तों, ये लेसन को हम दो हिस्सों में डिस्कशन करेंगे। पहला हिस्सा जिसमें हम डिस्कशन करेंगे कि कैसे ब्रिटिशर्स यहाँ आए थे एंड क्या सब पॉलिटिकल डेवलपमेंट हुआ था, दैट इज द पॉलिटिकल डेवलपमेंट्स इन इंडिया फ्रॉम 1600 AD टू 1947 AD ड्यूरिंग द कॉलोनियल एरा। एंड द सेकेंड पार्ट हम पढ़ेंगे मेकिंग ऑफ अवर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, स्टार्टिंग फ्रॉम द वेरी एस्टेब्लिशमेंट ऑफ अवर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन 1946 to 1950. In the first part, that is the political developments from 1600 AD to 1773. Let me tell you that not much development is seen during this time. This is also a part of company rule that was going on in India, and still we will study some of the major developments during this time. The Britishers came to India in 1600 AD as traders in the form of East India Company. Initially, the company had only exclusive trading rights as per a charter issued by Queen Elizabeth I. In 1765, the company obtained the Diwani of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. Diwani actually means the rights over revenue and civil justice, and hence this marks the beginning of a career as a territorial power. Friends, in 1773, the Regulating Act was passed. For the first time, it emphasized the political as well as the administrative role of the company, East India Company. It is also known for the reason that this laid the foundation of the centralized administration in India, or centralized rule in India.
So, under Regulating Act 1773, the governor of Bengal became the governor general of Bengal, and Lord Warren Hastings became the first governor general of Bengal. An executive council of four members was made to assist him. Governors of Bombay and Madras presidencies were made subordinate to governor general of Bengal. It provided for the establishment of a supreme court at Calcutta, and according to this, in 1774, a Supreme Court was established in Calcutta with a chief justice and three judges. The company servants cannot engage in any private trade or accept bribes or gifts from the natives according to the law. A court of directors was to report the revenue, civil and military affairs of the company in India.
After 1773, though the Britishers had tried to rectify the mistakes in an act, through an act in 1781, but some major developments are seen during the Pitt's India Act 1784. 1784 में जो Pitt's India Act आया उसमें कुछ बड़े changes लेके आए। For the first time, the company territories in India were termed as British possessions in India. Through this act, through the Pitt's India Act, the British government has been given supreme control over the company's administration in India. Let's study the Pitt's India Act 1784 in detail.
दोस्तों, Pitt's India Act 1784 में जो पहले जो इम्पोर्टेंट बदलाव आए थे, वो उसमें से सबसे इम्पोर्टेंट चीज़ ये है कि द पॉलिटिकल एंड कमर्शियल फंक्शंस ऑफ द कंपनी वर सेपरेटेड। द सेकेंड वन इज a new body known as Board of Control was made to look after the political affairs, whereas the Court of Directors was to manage the commercial affairs. पहले Court of Directors बनाया गया था जो company के day-to-day affairs British government को बताएगा, लेकिन बाद में अभी as per Pitt's India Act 1784 उसको ऐसा किया गया कि उसका जो पॉलिटिकल एंड कमर्शियल एक्टिविटी है उसको अलग कर दिया गया. द बोर्ड ऑफ कंट्रोल वॉज एम्पावर्ड टू सुपरवाइज एंड डायरेक्ट ऑल ऑपरेशन ऑफ द सिविल एंड मिलिटरी अफेयर्स एंड द रेवेन्यूज ऑफ द ब्रिटिश पोजिशन इन इंडिया. वेर इज द कोर्ट ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स वॉज रेस्ट्रिक्टेड टू मैनेज ओनली द कमर्शियल अफेयर्स.
After the Peace India Act 1784, two charter acts came. Pehla tha Charter Act 1833, dusra tha Charter Act 1853. Jo political developments Charter Act 1833 and 1853 ke तहत हुआ है वो हम अगले slide में discussion कर रहे हैं. ध्यान से सुनिए.
So friends, according to Charter Act 1833, the Governor General of Bengal was made the Governor General of India, and Lord William Bentinck was the first Governor General of India. And with this, all the civil and military powers are vested on him. The Governor of Bombay and Madras were deprived of their legislative power, and the East India Company was then become an administrative body. Before this it was a commercial body, and now it became as an administrative body. As per Charter Act 1853, the main postulates of the act are the legislative and executive functions of the Governor General's Council were separated. It established a separate Governor General's Legislative Council, which came to be known as Central Legislative Council. And a system of open competition was introduced for the selection and recruitment of civil services. These are some of the main changes that are made as per the Charter Act 1853. Along with these, for the first time, it introduced the local representation in the Central Legislative Council. वहाँ पर छः जो मेंबर थे, छः में से चार मेंबर ऐसे थे मतलब जिनको सिलेक्ट करना पड़ता था लोकल गवर्नमेंट. मद्रास, बम्बे, बेंगल एंड आगरा के लोकल गवर्नमेंट्स उसको सिलेक्ट करके भेजेंगे.
तो यहाँ से एक दूसरा सिलसिला शुरू हुआ. जैसे मैंने बताया कि पहला जो पार्ट था उसका फर्स्ट हिस्सा 1680 से 1773 तक, जिसमें कुछ ज़्यादा पॉलिटिकल डेवलपमेंट्स नहीं हुआ था. देन 1773 से 1858 तक ब्रिटिशर्स कुछ ना कुछ चेंजेस लाए थे. जो सबसे बड़ा चेंज आया कि कंपनी रूल एंड हो गया एंड क्राउन रूल शुरू हुआ, वो यहाँ से शुरू होता है. 1857 का सिपाही म्यूटिनी के बाद 1858 में 1858 में पहली बार आया गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1858.
द गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1858 ब्रॉट मेनी चेंजेस इन द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ ब्रिटिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी. द मेजर चेंज वाज द एबोलिशन ऑफ द रूल ऑफ ब्रिटिश ईस्ट इंडिया कंपनी. द रूल वाज ट्रांसफर्ड टू द ब्रिटिश क्राउन. The second most important thing that came in the Government of India Act 1858 was the Governor General of India became Viceroy of India, and Lord Canning was the first Viceroy of India. The system of double government, that is the rule by Board of Control and the Court of Directors, was abolished. A new office of Secretary of State was created with complete authority and control over Indian administration. But let me tell you that the Secretary of State is responsible to the British Parliament, as he was a member of the British Cabinet. And a 15-member council was made to assist the Secretary of State for India, and they have an advisory role only. And let me tell you that they are comprises of nominated bodies only. Official bodies, which are called as official bodies, and the Secretary of State for India was made the chairman of the council.
Government of India Act 1858 के बाद जो दूसरा बड़ा development आया वो Council of India Act 1861 के तहत आया. उसके बाद आया Council of India Act 1892. ये दोनों हम डिस्कशन करते हैं विस्तार से, जो चेंजेस हुआ है इसमें वो देखते हैं स्लाइड में।
For the Council of India Act 1861, the Viceroy should nominate some Indians as non-official members to the Executive Council. The then Viceroy, Lord Canning, nominated three members to the Executive Council. They are Raja of Banaras, the Maharaja of Patiala, and Sir Dinkar Rao. Decentralization was initiated by restoring the powers of the Bombay and Madras Presidency. New provincial councils for Bengal was established in 1861, 62, sorry. The Northwestern Frontier Province was established in 1866 and the Punjab was established in 1897. It gave recognition to the portfolio system introduced by Lord Canning in 1859. Then came the Council of India Act 1892. The number of non-official members in the central and provincial provincial councils were increased, but the number of the official majority was retained. It provided for the nomination of some non-official members of the Central Legislative Council by the Viceroy on the recommendations of the Provincial Legislative Councils and the Bengal Chambers of Commerce. It has a provision for the nomination of some non-official members to the Provincial Legislative Council by the governors of the governors on the recommendation of the district boards, municipalities, universities, trade associations, zamindars and chambers.
Council of India Act 1892 के बाद 1909 में आया मॉर्लेमेंटो रिफॉर्म्स। मॉर्लेमेंटो रिफॉर्म्स इज आल्सो नोन एज काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1909। एंड उसके बाद आया गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1919, व्हिच इज आल्सो नोन एज मंटागो ट्रांसपोर्ट रिफॉर्म।
Council of India Act 1909, which is also known as Marlimento Reforms, increased the size of legislative councils both at the central as well as provincial level. The official majority at the central legislative councils were retained, whereas the provincial legislative councils were allowed to have a non-official majority. इससे और एक चेंज क्या हुआ कि for the first time Viceroy's Executive Council में Indians को अलाउ किया गया एंड सत्येंद्र प्रसाद सिन्हा बिकेम द फर्स्ट इंडियन लॉयर टू एंटर इन टू द Viceroy's Executive Council. इट ऑल्सो इंट्रोड्यूस्ड द सिस्टम ऑफ कम्युनल रिप्रेजेंटेशन बाय क्रिएटिंग ए सेपरेट इलेक्ट्रेट फॉर मुस्लिम. मुस्लिम लोगों के लिए एक अलग इलेक्ट्रेट बनाया गया. इसीलिए लॉर्ड मिंटो को फादर ऑफ कम्युनल इलेक्ट्रेट कहा जाता है. उसके बाद आता है गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1919, व्हिच इज आल्सो नोन एज मंटागो ट्रांसपोर्ट रिफॉर्म्स. इन मंटागो ट्रांसपोर्ट रिफॉर्म्स द सेंट्रल एंड द प्रोविंशियल सब्जेक्ट्स वर सेपरेटेड. द प्रोविंशियल सब्जेक्ट्स वर अगेन डिवाइडेड इनटू द ट्रांसपोर्ट सब्जेक्ट्स एंड द रिजर्व सब्जेक्ट. दिस इज कॉल्ड एज डायरकी. डायरकी मीन्स ड्यूअल गवर्नमेंट. बायकैमरलिज्म एंड डायरेक्ट इलेक्शंस आर आल्सो इंट्रोड्यूस्ड इन इंडिया फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम. बायकैमरलिज्म मतलब होता है कि लोअर हाउस एंड अपर हाउस का होना, मतलब लोकसभा राज्यसभा जैसे दो हाउस होना. ये भी पहली बार इंट्रोड्यूस किया गया इसमें. सेपरेट इलेक्टोरेट्स आर आल्सो मेड. इलेक्टोरेट्स जैसे मुस्लिम के लिए बनाया गया था मॉर्लेमेंटो रिफॉर्म में, वैसे मंटागो ट्रांसपोर्ट रिफॉर्म में सिख्स, इंडियन क्रिश्चियंस, एंग्लो इंडियंस एंड यूरोपियन के लिए अलग अलग इलेक्टोरेट बनाया गया. सेंट्रल पब्लिक सर्विस कमीशन बनाने का एक प्रोविजन इसमें रखा गया था, जिसके तहत 1926 में पहला सेंट्रल पब्लिक सर्विस कमीशन बना एंड द प्रोविंशियल बजट्स जो सेंट्रल बजट होता है उससे अलग कर दिया गया पहली बार. ये था गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1900.
गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1919 के बाद आया गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया एक्ट 1935. The Government of India Act 1935 is considered as the Magna Carta of the Constitution of India, as most of the provisions of Government of India Act 1935 were enshrined in our Constitution.
Government of India Act 1935. Federalism Government of India Act 1935 का एक बड़ा important feature है. पहली बार federalism को introduce किया गया. फेडरलिज्म का मतलब होता है कि सेंटर एंड स्टेट में प्रोविंसेस में पावर का डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन करना. और ये जो पावर का डिस्ट्रीब्यूट हुआ ये तीन लिस्ट के आधार पर हुआ, दैट इज द फेडरल लिस्ट, द प्रोविंशियल लिस्ट एंड द कंकरेंट लिस्ट. फेडरलिस्ट मतलब जो कि सेंटर को बिलोंग करता है और प्रोविंशियल लिस्ट मतलब जो प्रोविंसेस को बिलोंग करता है, कॉन्करेंट लिस्ट का मतलब होता है जो दोनों को बिलोंग करता है, एंड डायरेक्टली इन द प्रोविंसेस वॉज एबोलिस्ट एंड द प्रोविंशियल ऑटोनोमी वॉज ग्रांटेड, डायरेक्टली वॉज इंट्रोड्यूस्ड एट द सेंटर. इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ बाइकैमरलिज्म इन 6 आउट ऑफ 11 प्रोविंसेस, दैट इज इट बॉम्बे, बंगाल, मद्रास, बिहार, आसाम एंड द यूनाइटेड प्रोविंसेस. द काउंसिल ऑफ इंडिया वॉज एबोलिस्ट. It provided for the establishment of the Reserve Bank of India and it provides for the establishment of a federal court.
At last, after the Government of India Act 1935, it came the Government of India Act 1947. The major provisions of the Government of India Act 1947 are:
so as per the Indian Independence Act 1947, the British rule was ended and India was declared as an independent and sovereign state from 15th August 1947. The Indian Independence Act 1947 provided for the partition of India as Pakistan and India with right to secede from the British Commonwealth. Office of the Viceroy was abolished and Lord Mountbatten became the first Governor General of Independent India. Let me tell you that C. Rajgopalachari became the first Indian Governor General of Independent India and he was also the last Governor General of Independent India. The Government of India Act 1947 or the Indian Independence Act 1947 empowers the Constituent Assembly to frame their independent constitutions separately for Pakistan as well as for India. The office of the Secretary of State was abolished and the power was transferred, his power and functions were transferred to the Secretary of State for Commonwealth Affairs. It granted freedom to the Indian princely states either to join the domain of India or the domain of Pakistan or remain independent. मतलब कैसा है कि princely states अगर चाहे तो India में join कर सकते हैं, या तो Pakistan में join कर सकते हैं, या नहीं तो independent भी रह सकते हैं.
This is all about the political developments during the colonial era, starting from 1600 AD to 1947. कि क्या सब political development इसी दौरान हुआ था, 1600 AD से लेके 1947 के बीच में क्या सब political development हुआ था. अभी हम देखेंगे कि हमारा constitution कैसे बना. एक देश run करने के लिए, एक देश बनाने के लिए, एक sovereign region बनाने के लिए ये जरूरी होता है कि उसका एक कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन बनाया जाए. तो ये कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन का कंसेप्ट आया कहाँ से, कैसे बना अपना कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन, कहाँ कहाँ से लिया गया इसका प्रोविजन, ये सब हम वन बाय वन डिस्कशन करेंगे. द आइडिया ऑफ मेकिंग अ कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन वाज फर्स्ट पुट फोर्थ बाय एम एन रॉय, हु इज ऑल्सो कंसिडर्ड द पायनियर ऑफ कम्युनिस्ट मूवमेंट इन इंडिया इन 1934. इन 1935 इंडियन नेशनल कांग्रेस डिमांडेड, officially demanded that there is need of a constituent assembly to frame our constitution. In 1938, Jawaharlal Nehru declared on behalf of Indian National Congress that the constitution of free India must be developed by a constituent assembly without any outside interference, and the constituent assembly should be formed by elected members elected through adult franchise. In 1940, the British government accepted the demand of formation of a constituent assembly through August of War. In 1942, Crick's mission came with a draft proposal of making the constituent assembly after the World War II.
So friends, the Constituent Assembly was constituted in November 1946 under the scheme proposed by the Cabinet Mission Plan. As per the plan, the total strength of the Constituent Assembly was to be 389 out of which 296 seats were allotted to British India, 93 seats to the princely states, and out of the 296 seats that are allotted to British India, 292 members were to be drawn from the 11 provincial governors, 4 from the 4 chief commissioners of the provinces. And hence we can say that the Constituent Assembly was a partly elected and partly nominated body. The election to the Constituent Assembly was held in July-August 1946, where out of 296 seats, INC won 208, INC matlab Indian National Congress won 208 and Muslim League won 73 seats, and small independent groups won 15 seats, and 93 seats allotted to the princely states were not filled.
Though the Constituent Assembly was formed in November 1946, but the first meeting was held on December 9, 1946. The first meeting was attended by 211 members. The Muslim League boycotted it, and it was presided by Dr. Sachidananda Sinha. On 11th December 1946, Dr. Rajendra Prasad was elected as the President of the Constituent Assembly. S.C. Mukherjee is elected as the Vice President of the Constituent Assembly, and Dr. B.N. Rao was elected as the Advisor of the Constituent Assembly.
Some of the important committees formed by the Constituent Assembly and their heads are given below. Number 1, the Union Power Committee, headed by Jawaharlal Nehru. Union Constituent Committee, headed by Jawaharlal Nehru. Provincial Constitution Committee, headed by Sardar Patel. Drafting Committee, headed by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. So there are, friends, numerous committees that are formed by Constituent Assembly in order to frame the Constitution. We cannot discuss all those, all of those committees here. So if you want, then please write that means in the comment box, or personally mail me in sanku6626@gmail.com so that I can send it to you. Out of these committees, drafting committee was the most important one. It was set up on August 29, 1947. It had 7 members, chaired by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. The other 6 members are N. Gopalaswamy Iyengar, Alladi Krishnaswamy Iyer, Dr. K. Munshi, Syed Muhammad Sadullah, N. Madhav Rao, and T.T. Krishnamachari. The Constitution was adopted on 26 November 1949. It contained 395 articles and 8 schedules. Dr. B.R. Ambedkar was regarded as father of Constitution of India and modern menu because of his role in framing the Constitution. Though the Constitution was adopted on 26 January 1949, adopted means it was signed on 26 November 1949, but full-fledged it came into effect on January 26, 1950, and hence the date January 26, 1950 has been regarded as the date of commencement of our Constitution, and it is celebrated as the Republic Day. The day coincides with the Purna Swaraj Day as celebrated in 1930 as per a resolution passed in the Lahore session in 1929.
Here, one thing I want to tell you, that whenever the Constituent Assembly met as a constitutional body after the enactment of 1947 Government of India Act, it was presided by Dr. Rajendra Prasad. But when it met as a legislative body, it was presided by C.V. Mavalankar. So remember this part, because this is very important for the prelim point of view. At last, let us discuss about the criticism of the Constituent Assembly. This is very important for the mains point of view. So remember these points.
So here are some criticism of the Constituent Assembly. जो पहला था वो नॉट ए रिप्रेजेंटेटिव बॉडी. रिप्रेजेंटेटिव बॉडी का मतलब होता है कि द मेंबर्स आर नॉट इलेक्टेड डायरेक्टली बाय द पीपल थ्रू एडल्ट फ्रेंचाइज. नंबर टू आता है नॉट ए सोवरेन बॉडी. इट इज़ नॉट ए सोवरेन बॉडी बिकॉज ये एक ब्रिटिश प्रपोजल के तहत हुआ है, तो ये एक सोवरेन बॉडी नहीं है. एंड इट टुक वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम, सो इट इज़ टाइम कंज्यूमिंग. फॉर दैट रीजन ऑल्सो इट इज़ क्रिटिसाइज्ड. And largely it is dominated by the Congress, and the members were mostly lawyers and politicians, whereas people from other fields were not seen here. The last criticism was it was dominated by Hindus, whereas the representatives of other community like Sikh, Christians and Muslims were not seen here.
So friends, this is all for today. Agar mera video pasand aaya तो इसे लाइक, शेयर एंड सब्सक्राइब करना मत भूलिए. and wait for the second part of this introductory Indian polity, where I will discuss about some of the questions that came in the examination and some probable questions also. And along with that, we will go for the next part.